Good, we've done everything in good time. How are you, Rahul? You can unmute yourself.
All good, sir.
Okay, okay, great. You are at home?
I'm at home, sir, working from home today.
So, good. Is your office running or are your work it's, more work from home?
No, sir, it's running. It's just that today I took a break off. I had to stay at home. There was some work going on at home. So running some errands. So it's good to work from home sometimes.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely.
It's the new order now, I believe.
It's the new order. a lot of companies have... I have a friend who is into... he's, of course, in a software company and all that. So they're more... And a very big one. And for a month, he was in Dehradun. I said, what are you doing there? He said, I'm working from home.
Right, sir.
So he was having fun. He's come back and he's saying he just got a notice circular from the office that even after offices open up and start, they're still going to continue this for a good portion of their staff on a permanent basis.
Yeah, one thing that's happened, sir, is that we also had a work from home for many months. And I think you end up getting more work out of people. Because in my case, I'm an employer, so I obviously generate jobs.
And yeah, would be quite worried that people are goofing off.
They're not actually. They end up working harder and now there is no weekend. So technically, when you're working in the office, there's always a set pattern and time. And they'll say, okay, I'm in travel, I'm in transit, I'm going home. And you can't... Now what happens is you give them the work and it has to be done. And whether it's night or day. So actually, they're getting fatigued now. And a lot of people have, you know, smaller families, smaller homes. It's not easy. I think it's going to be, like I said, there's not a right solution to this. But I think a lot of people will work from home, good and bad. But yes, things are changing. I think the consulting jobs, a lot of people, we have auditors in Deloitte, and they have worldwide taken a mandate of doing permanent work from home culture for many of people. They don't need to be there. You save a lot of money. You save on infrastructure, you know, transit, commute. And I think, but yeah, it's pretty taxing because mentally a lot of people can get pretty affected with it. So, you know, if you're sitting in Goa, Dehradun, I would say you would not. But if you're sitting in a city where there's everybody working from home, it can be pretty tiresome.
In our earlier webinar, of course, this was perhaps a little stretched, you know, that some of the real estate prices have been improving, in fact, in spite of COVID. And this person was trying to sort of argue that a lot of it is that people are buying outside the city because some of them feel that they don't have to buy in the core city in a small little place and they're actually buying outside, sort of spreading themselves.
Yes.
And this has put up, you know, sort of a premium on some of the, in some areas on that.
No, it is in my instance too, you know, our marketing, social media, digital marketing used to be done by a firm in Gurgaon, obviously based on Gurgaon, Delhi NCR. They were pretty expensive to us. And when we had to cut costs, you know, we moved it to Indore and we're getting a better job out of outfit in Indore at, you know, a ridiculously low price with better quality. And then we had a legal firm, which was based in Delhi. We moved it to a legal firm in Goa. And these are a bunch of Delhiites and Bombayites who gone and started a legal firm in Goa. Because these are not litigation lawyers, they are corporate lawyers. They can sit anywhere and work from. And it's much more better work because they're happier there, sitting in a villa in Goa and working from there. So I think that's the new norm. We see a lot of our business from tier 2 and 3 cities. We're in 16 cities as the brand. And I've seen better recovery in tier 2 and 3. And, you know, there's a lot of people who reverse migrated now. Like I'm in Gurgaon. I can tell you the corporate culture here, you don't see anybody. Buildings are empty.
Right. And only recently before COVID, a lot of companies like I know Zomato and all, they bought huge space, bigger and bigger space, and they want to put all everyone together. And now it's running empty, you know. So it's, I know my son who is in, you met him, of course, in Zomato.
Yes.
Last three, four months, he's been working from home. I mean, I step out more often than him. He's there. But anyway, such is the things. We are all in place. It's 5 o'clock, so this is fantastic timing. So I think the host, Mr. Somani, if we are all set, we are ready to start. At least our high power panelists are ready to start.
So I'm just waiting for this PPT to be over.
Okay, sure. So Mr. Rao, are you also work from home in your office or partially?
Yes, we know, actually fully.
100%. Fully, okay.
100% work from home for the last 9 months.
Okay, so that's good. And of course, I think this is heralding some permanent changes down the line of companies work. And I think it's for the better. Right now, there's so much earlier, so much pressure on transportation, you have thousands of people going through latakkar metro se ja rahe hain, all that. I've gone through all that.
So, hello and welcome everybody. And
hello
our panel of experts, Mr. Rahul Singh, Mr. Sanjay Kulkarni, Narasimha Rao, and Mr. Vivek Pandey. In First Time's commitment to bring to its students as well as to the people around us, including the IMA fraternity, a series of pertinent, relevant, business-related questions and issues. Welcome to this series of webinars. And we have our experts here today. We read about them in the small resumes that we have just displayed before you, and I would not come between all of you and the experts. So over to you, Vinod, to moderate this interesting and thought-provoking discussion.
Okay, thank you, Anil. I welcome everyone. I welcome our panel of experts, all of them heavyweights. Even if they're not physically heavyweight, but they are certainly mentally heavyweights. And I'm sure you would have gone through their sort of resumes, which we had put up earlier and sent across. We have Mr. Rahul Singh, who is, I won't go through the whole thing, but really just introduce them. Mr. Rahul Singh, who is the founder and CEO of the Beer Cafe. He's, of course, had a very illustrious experience before that, before he became an entrepreneur. He's worked with some very good names. Mr. Narasimha Rao, who's the Senior Vice President of Agro Tech Foods. And he has a lot of in-depth experience in the field of HR. We have Mr. Sanjay Kulkarni, who is, again, he's the advisor to a number of companies. He's an independent director. He has been famous for being in the 20th Century Finance Corp at a time when it shook the industry and did a lot of innovative moves many moons ago, if I can say that. And then we have Mr. Pandey, who has a great breadth of experience, which spans many areas. In terms of retailing, in terms of general management, cross-functional areas. So we have a really very fascinating, and as I said, a very heavyweight sort of group to deliberate. And I hope the webinar today brings out the best out of people. And I hope if we don't just have a lecture, but really a discussion. Okay, so good, because this is an innovative topic. Let me also start by thanking First Timer for sort of bringing this webinar to fruition, as they have done other knowledge sessions and so forth. As you know, FirstTimer has been founded by the class of 73 from IMA, and they focus and we focus on academic excellence to nurture the professionals of today. But today is very different from yesterday, and tomorrow is going to be very different. Okay. But the topic for today is who will ensure tomorrow's success in your company? It's a very pertinent point because times are changing. It's not just the COVID, but really there's a lot of technological change that is happening. There's a lot of social change. There's a lot of geopolitical things which have changed. Who could have, you know, like China is coming out and so forth. These are, of course, broader issues. But today we are working on the company. Who will ensure tomorrow's success in your company? And we are talking about what is most, which is the most critical or crucial function or department in a company that will leverage business success. A lot of companies under stress, particularly now, but even before now, because of these changes. So who will lead these companies? Which department? Would it be finance or marketing? Or let me put it in context so that we all understand this a little better. Long time back, when I joined Bata's, which was in 1980s, they proudly took me to Bata Nagar. Bata at that time was headquartered in Kolkata, and Bata Nagar was a whole township built by Bata's when they came to India. They had huge factories, 10,000 workers, and they proudly told me that this is you know, the real ethos of Bata, which was production. Bata was totally production-led. Of course, I joined as head of apparel and accessories because we were, with Murjani, we were going to launch apparel and accessories in the marketing areas. So I was really flabbergasted when they introduced me to my boss, the vice president marketing, and he had been transferred from the factory. Imagine my boss, the marketing head, was a factory person who, because the most important thing in Bata was the factory, and it was factory led. The distribution, other things, marketing came secondary. And the mission statement I remember at that time was that Bata is the, the mission statement was the, is the manufacturer to the world, is the footwear manufacturer to the world. That was the thing. And I first wondered, have I joined in the right place? But anyway, factory was the thing. But within 6 months, there were major changes. The first non-Bata managing director, they were all other otherwise used to be promoted from inside, usually from the factory to managing director rank abroad. And the first managing director came from Hindustan Unilever. Imagine. Because times were changing, and I think Bata at that time, headquartered in Toronto, Canada, realized that the new winds were marketing led. And of course, we have seen that in terms of customer is king and so forth. So variously, product and distribution, marketing. So today, at least till recently, I was attending my class, I teach marketing. It is in marketing. I used to say that the real crux of a company is marketing. It's marketing led. And if you want to be managing director of a company, it will be the CEO will come through marketing because this is what will make the difference. But really times have changed also. And I am open to all sorts of suggestions. And in particular, just to again, I'm taking a few more minutes extra so that we are in the right sort of sync with each other. But today when I see a lot of startups and other things and so forth, and even big companies like Google and other things, when they pay a crore plus to someone who is just out of college or just a year or two down the line, I say that they say perhaps the real crux, because things are changing very fast, there's a lot of adaptation required. You require people, and it has to be people-led, and that comes first. And this is where HR sort of perhaps should be leading the company. And this is where it is. And of course, we come full circle because I think when I was in IMA, we were taught about business strategy, and we said, what business are you in? Perhaps that is the most important question. And then, of course, we forgot about it for 50 years because we built big factories and all that. But today, again, should we be asking which business are we in and what should be the strategy? Okay, with that thought in mind, I think we will start. And the format that we are going to use is very much what we did last time. I'm going to call in turn each person on the high table, if I can use the word, or on the dais, and give their 5-6 minutes of uninterrupted thought. We have asked each of the panelists to choose a function, whether it's marketing or finance or others, to choose a function which they feel fits the bill of who will ensure tomorrow's success in your company, and they will defend that. And so after each of the four have spoken, we will have a discussion between the four, and at the end of it, we will so let's start. Let me call on the first speaker, Mr. Rahul Singh. Rahul, of course, we have known each other for very long, and you have been been many marketing-oriented companies and brands like Reebok, and of course, you've been an entrepreneur in terms of brand building and other things, but you have chosen finance as the crux of today. Can you tell us about why you feel finance is the big sort of function which will determine the success of a business?
So thank you. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the forum. Being the first panelist also has its advantages and disadvantages. So going first is what I'm doing right now. I've been a professional who turned entrepreneur 15 years. I worked in various companies, Fortune 500 global companies. I also work with Mr. Call in Stencil. That was the first company I started working in. So I'm not an MBA. I'm not a finance person. I'm not a chartered accountant. I'm a textile engineer who's selling beer. But I can tell you, in these 28 years between being a professional and then 13 years of being an entrepreneur, I've kind of gone through every possible role, including being a janitor, a photocopier, a courier boy, and whatever you. And one of the best ones was to be a bartender. So that's every man's dream, to be a bartender. And I've been through that too. Having said that, the context is what's for tomorrow. Now, tomorrow is a very big word. Tomorrow means tomorrow, or tomorrow means, you know, in the near future or distant future. The way things have, COVID's kind of turned around. We were supposed to be having a great year, 2020. I think the best of missions and visions made for 2020. I have a feeling that if there were millions of PowerPoints ever made across the world, nobody ever put COVID as the word, and, you know, as something that could have disrupted the way the world works. So I really look at it in a very short term right now. Very simply, alone, we can go fast. Together, we can go far. And that's something that we have to do with departments. Now, the word department itself is putting people into boundaries. So I came from a background where everything was department. You do this. I'm a production department. I'm an operations department. I'm a purchase department. I'm a marketing department. I think the world's kind of become smaller. It's seamless. And the way we function our enterprise now is that, you know, you do have a function that you do, but we don't see yourselves and ourselves as a department. We're all in the common mission to do what we have to do. But yes, you have certain skill sets. Somebody who cooks food would have a skill set to cook food, but that doesn't mean that he's not involved in the strategy of the company. So the way we look at it, we have 700 people working in our organization or the enterprise as we speak. We've kind of made it more seamless. And this is all thanks to COVID. It allowed us about 5 months of downtime, where in these 5 months, we didn't have a single rupee revenue. I would have never had a plan or business plan or any of that sort, which would have had a business plan which says 5 months of no work, absolutely zero revenues, because we are dealing in the business of alcohol beverage, which was banned in India for 5 months. September, we reopened. It's been 3 months of reopening. We went from a survive stage to a revive stage, and very soon the thrive stage will happen. But why did I choose finance? It came from a perspective that I've done all the functions, and finance to me was more accounting, to be honest. We have a CFO, we have an accounting team, and it was managing the money, but it was more about numbers being managed. And what is brought to our context today and where we stand today is that without money, we can't do anything. You know, it just made us come to a standstill where the entire engine stopped. And without capital, where will we go from here? So for me, the finance word comes in from not just, you know, a really what you call an extremely fine-combed strategy in terms of figuring out how much money you have, what's your reserves, how will you go through this stage, you know, what we've gone through, and how will we, you know, pick up pieces back and go through it. But more importantly, the need of capital. So in spite of the best of business plan, the best of, you know, the team that we have from an HR perspective, you know, the best of product and, you know, the locations, without money, we're done, you know, and that came out as a root shock that, you know, money definitely is an important part. So the finance word for me is not just managing the money, but it's also the capital front to it. You know, without this capital, we would be nowhere. And capital is difficult in an industry which is seen as one of the worst industries or one of the most affected industries. So aviation, for that matter, entertainment or hospitality, whether it's hotel or restaurants, were the most impacted industries due to COVID. So, you know, nobody's going to give you money right now. Nobody will give you capital when I come to it. No bank will dole us money. Nobody will give us any debt. Equity is tough to get. And this is where we stand. And in this realm, while we are going through this, we also have the two best IPOs India has ever seen in the last 10 days. So if I look at Burger King India, you know, they wanted to have a fresh issue of 450 crores. They got bids for 70,000 crores. And just yesterday, you know, Mrs. Bector, Cremica closed down, which is again an F&B company, which had to raise a fresh issue of 540 crores. And they raised 100,000 crores of bids. That's 192 times oversubscription in the middle of COVID. So I'm just saying, this is where the capital market is. It's seeing a different part. It's seeing a consumer market. It's seeing, you know, how deep our industry is. And that is what's, you know, driving the market forces. But again, it comes back to capital. The capital market is driving a market. And that means money is an important part. And as an entrepreneur, I can tell you, I am just been managing money for the last 4 months, you know, 5 months of no work, and then 3 months of a lot of work. And then next 6 months going to be even more difficult, because the recovery is not going to happen overnight. It will take a while. So we'll have to go through this revival process. And that's the reason, the long and short of it, I chose finance, because to me, that's the hat I've been wearing for the last now almost 9 months. And I think I'll be wearing that hat for the next 6 to 7 months. So when you said tomorrow, that's the 6 months I'm looking at. And then let's see where we'd go from here. I hope the vaccine and the news around it and the entire exuberance that the world's seeing at this point in time should make this world come back to normalcy very soon.
Okay, thank you, Rahul. I think you underlined the point that ultimately it's finance, especially when the chips are down and especially when the going is rocky. And of course, this is the time. But once you get into the discussion, I would like to challenge you, not just for 6 months, but let's say in the next 5 years or 10 years, perhaps we'll keep it as a discussion point. So let me move on to Mr. Narasimha Rao. Mr. Narasimha Rao, of course, has great depth in HR. And the sort of challenge I'd like to put is that HR has traditionally been thought as a sort of a staff function. It has lately become important in many ways, and it's been used as a driving point, perhaps today, by many companies. What has changed, and is it really true that HR is making a lot of difference in companies? Yes.
Yes. Coming from HR, so I would support HR to be playing the most important role in leveraging the organization's success going forward. Why I say that, yes, we know you are right. HR has come a long way from what it was maybe about 30, 35 years and now. So I have been in HR department for the last 35 years, and I have seen a range of transformation of this department. Once it used to be a department to deal with the union because nobody wanted to deal with the union. So we need a person to deal with them. So that's why HR department was there. Then it went into a transaction piece that we need to have somebody to do the recruitment, selection, et cetera, et cetera. So off late, definitely it is playing a strategic business partner role. One of the most important ally of MD today, managing director or CEO, is the HR person, because the human capital is something which is abundant in terms of its discretionary efforts. So what we say, four M's in the organization: man, material, money, and a machine. So the machine, men, and money have limitations, but men have no limitations. The discretionary effort that the men or the human capital can bring into the success of the organization is enormous. So that is when this employee engagement and the motivation, morale, et cetera, have come into place. Now, in an organization where you have a higher engagement levels, the employees, the discretionary effort that they can give is just enormous. You cannot really measure that effort. So why I say that HR is going to play a very important role in time to come, maybe like you said, about 6 months. So currently, the situation is because of this COVID, there's a lot of tension, you know, and the low morale. Because of this situation, organizations have had to take hard calls in terms of delaying increments or job cuts or the salary cuts, etc. So post-liberalization after 90, this is the first time when employees are feeling that they are at a low bargaining power, you know. So till now, they have had a very good run in terms of their bargaining power. Now their morale is very low. So when the organizations actually will come back to normal from this COVID situation, we need to deal with this low morale employees. And also they are looking for an opportunity that when it opens up, there will be a huge amount of attrition. There will be a huge amount of poaching. So you are going to lose a lot of good talent from your organization. So how do you deal with it? How do you retain your best employees? And how do you keep continuing to focus on the organization? So these are some of the challenges organizations have faced. And CEOs definitely will be concerned to lose their best talent when the time to revive comes into place. So replacement of good talent is not easy. But it comes with a cost. And also it comes with a lot of disturbance within the organization. So how do you deal with that kind of a scenario? So these challenges definitely will put HR at the forefront as the strongest support for the CEO to drive the organization to deal with these issues and challenges going forward. So that's why I keep definitely HR at the forefront in leveraging this organization's success.
Thank you, Mr. Rao. I think your points are well made, that HR today is in the forefront, and the company really moves ahead because of its talent. And really, times have changed from the last 35 years, where the cutting edge today is provided by people in various circumstances. And I think today, there is a thinner line between entrepreneurs and companies, where companies expect employees to be entrepreneurs also. So perhaps we can speak about this a little more in our discussion. So I'd like to move on to Mr. Kulkarni. Mr. Kulkarni has a huge depth in the finance area. So I think it was very natural that he chose finance as the real leverage. And of course, things don't happen without money. We all know that. But what makes it crucial for success? Yes, Sanjay.
Thanks, Vinod, and thanks for having me on this seminar. As you said, I've been in finance for 45 years, so I don't know anything other than that. And, Rahul did give us his issues relating to finance in a micro sense in terms of what he's been facing. But let me put the entire finance function in a bit of a macro situation and see what has happened. You know, in 1991, when everything was liberalized, our GDP was $270 billion. $270 billion. And today, this year, it's going to be $2.8 trillion. And if you account for the rupee versus dollar at this rate, you can imagine that our GDP has gone up nearly 15 times in this 30 years. At that time, we had only banks to whom we could go for borrowing the money. But today, the multiplicity of sources is so high. And, you know, right from banks, which are only one option, you have equity, you have private equity, you have listed equity, you have angels who are available, a lot of HNIs who have money, you have debentures, bonds, you have refinance from NHBs and SIDBs, you can borrow foreign loans, you can have leasing, hire purchase, factoring, etc. So to the extent that your finance department is able to access this various sources of finance, your company will always be better placed as compared to its competitors. The problem has been that the kind of people who have been in finance in the past, and pardon my saying this, have primarily been, as Rahul said, accountants. There's a massive difference between accounting and finance. And the sooner anybody realizes that we need a finance guy rather than accounting is what makes the difference. See, finance is not about paying cost and interest. Finance is also about saving the interest that you pay. So if you pay an interest of 10%, and if you're able to save 1%, that accounting or finance department has made much more money than probably anybody else. So you really have to look at finance in a completely different way today than how you looked at finance in the past. And that is one of the biggest things. Second thing is, finance is also about future. You don't have to look at what money I have. You have to look at what is my plan for the future, and what do I need in terms of money for doing that. And therefore, the cash flows that you require for the future is what is going to enable you to do whatever your ambitions and your vision is. So therefore, the finance and having it at the right price becomes extremely important if you were to run your company profitably. So another thing was, HR, NNR said HR is important, but I want to make a difference between what is function is important in which industry. You see, HR is probably more important in the things like IT, where you have to recruit a lot of people, retain a lot of people. But there are some other guys, like, for example, a Swiggy or a Zomato may not need HR. They will, of course, but not to the extent that somebody else needs, you know? So frankly, every function is required. To me, all the functions put together are like the five fingers of your hand, you know, they're all required. Which one is required more in this particular industry depends on what the industry is and what is it that you hope to achieve.
Yes, Sanju, thank you for your elucidation on finance. And you focus on the macro side. If the finance doesn't run your factory, the fact is it lays the bedrock, and perhaps it's like a railway which runs on track. Critical, very well put. But you have also thrown some challenges that for some companies, we will talk about that, about Swiggy and Zomato. You said that HR may not be really critical from there. I don't know if Mr. Narasimha Rao would take issue with that. But we will leave that for a little later. And now I kept Mr. Pandey to the last because he's had a tremendous breadth of experience, both in India and abroad, and in various functions and other areas. We were together at one time in DCM Benetton. Without further qualification, Vivek, tell us, when I talked to Vivek, since he has had a breadth of experience, I thought, will he pick up finance? Will he pick up HR? Will he pick up something else? But he picked up something which didn't come to my mind, which was business strategy. Okay, and then I said, business strategy is important, but you know, it's always in the back of your mind, and perhaps every few years you revisit that. But you know, once you make your mission statement, you're set for 50 years. But I think perhaps Vivek will take issue with that. So tell us, Vivek, why did you choose business strategy? What's so critical about it?
Yeah, thank you, Vinod. But before that, let me compliment you on choosing a very provocative subject, that which of the function is more important. I think you have deliberately put this spanner, if I may say. We all know none of the functions are mutually exclusive. It's not an either or situation. And each function is interdependent on the other. So, but I must say it's really provocative. Having said that, you know, I personally think when I talked about strategy, I thought it's something very overarching. In fact, one can even make a case that is it really one of the functions at all, of course, since it's all pervasive. And before I elaborate, I think I'll just make one small thing clear. Strategy itself has got two components. It could be either a corporate strategy or business strategy. Now, supposing you have a multi-business organization. So the corporate strategy, there will be where to compete, say in which businesses to be in, which businesses to divest, which businesses to diversify into, the new businesses to enter, that famous Boston consulting model matrix of which of your businesses are in the category of dogs or stars or the cash cow. And then based on that, you can decide which businesses to remain in, where to pump in more money, finances, to quote Sanju and Rahul. So basically, the other thing is the business strategy. When we now come to the business level, which are the new product innovations we are talking in that particular business. Now we are talking of with whom to compete, that famous Michael Porter's strategic model of whether we should compete based on the cost effectiveness, whether we should compete on product differentiation, or should we go for a niche, the three main elements which he talks about. So all this is part of the business strategy, which we call for a particular business. So basically, we have to first define what we are. The strategy actually flows from our vision, our mission, and our corporate goals. I would like to give some example. Say, we have all heard of the Melinda and Bill Gates Foundation, which is one of the biggest organizations in the world for charity. There's another organization, smaller in size, known as the Omidyar Network. In fact, my son Varad happens to be a partner there. So I claim to know something more about this organization. How it is different from the Gates Foundation, because they have decided their raison d'etre, the reason for their existence, the purpose of that existence, that they will fund entrepreneurs who are making a social impact. So they are not into charity as such. They are saying we will identify new startups which has got major social impact. And if we see that there is value in it, we will invest at the seed capital level. And as the business grows, when it has become viable enough for the conventional business entrepreneur to enter, That is the time they will exit. In fact, recently we all must have heard of White Hat Junior, that was funded by Omidyar Network, and they just exited after I think 31x returns. So that return, now they will reinvest again in social impact business. Now I just want to say, okay, how this their business is so distinctly different from the Bill Gates Foundation business, although they are both in relatively same domain. So that is why strategy and its formulation becomes the overarching point. Then only once we have decided, then we talk, okay, now how to market, how to get the funds. So in a way, I think it's a bit unfair comparison with other functions. I can give you one another small example. I have many up my sleeves actually, because I was lucky, particularly in the 14 years in the Gulf, I had an exposure to probably at least 50 to 60 international brands. We were the exclusive franchisees or distributors. A very interesting example could be of Swarovski. You know, when Swarovski started, they were basically in the collectible business, like figurines, miniatures, and, you know, things like those. And then they started the fashion jewelry segment. Till 10 years back, 85% of the sales of Swarovski was in the collectible business, and only 10-15% was the fashion jewelry. And then they suddenly sensed that this collectible business is more a planned purchase, while the fashion business is more an impulsive purchase. And there is a huge space, a vacuum existing there worldwide in the low-cost fashion jewelry business. And they made a strategic shift. And they said, now let us focus more on this, because they could anticipate this is the growing business. And today it is exactly the opposite. Their sales of fashion jewelry, which includes say, earrings, rings, bangles, watches, all that today forms 80% of their total business. So this is the strategic shift I'm talking about. And therefore I reiterate, it is an overarching function and hence not really a competing function. With having decided that this is your strategic shift, then the marketing strategies come. How do we now market it? How do we now? And of course, how do we fund it? I have many other examples to give, Vinod. Maybe you'll give me another chance to share them with you.
Yes, we will have many chances, and I would urge you to speak out. Fine. Thank you, Vivek. You have put it very strongly. You are saying the question doesn't arise. I mean, it's very obvious that business strategy is what makes companies. And and this is a tried and tested thing. It's not as if we are suddenly starting with business strategy. I mean, they taught us 50 years ago at IMA perhaps, or anywhere else. And you've given recent examples of things like Swarovski and so forth. So now what we will do is we'll go into a discussion mode. And in the end, we'll, of course, have questions and answers. But in the discussion mode, I'd like to say that you are all free to speak. So don't hold back. And it doesn't have to be one-on-one. And since we are not sitting next to each other, we can really speak out because no one will catch you by the neck. So that is one of the good reasons of being online. So I've got a good handle, and I'll start with that. Mr. Kulkarni said that, yes, HR may be really strategic and key in companies like IT, but really it falls flat in a lot of other places like Swiggy and Zomato and so forth. So what do you have to say to that, Mr. Rao? HR may be a good in a few odd companies, but really it's not the really big idea in terms of what is critical.
So I will offer my perspective what Sanjay said about this. Some of these companies may not require HR. So my view is that in some of these unstructured companies, HR is more important because they are almost like they're startups and then they're growing. And in the growing companies, there are no structures. You know, structures evolve as they are growing. So in the absence of a proper HR management, you will end up creating a lot of chaos. So suddenly you hear about Swiggy people on strike and Zomato people struck work. You know, these are some of the things that you listen. So why those things are happening? Because there is no proper HR creating an environment where these companies can grow in a structured manner. So they are growing and then they are just going along with the flow. So my suggestion would be that HR is not limited to few companies. HR is actually, it's like air, you know, it's everywhere. So in whichever company it is, I think the strong HR should be there to leverage the companies. And Sanjay's other point also, when he said, money is not the problem. The people who are managing the finance is the problem. You know, so their ability to differentiate between accounting and financing is the issue. So this is also where the people issue and their capability issue. So this is where HR plays an important role, you know, bringing the right people, building their capability, providing an environment, and then making them to excel in the organization. That's the way HR contributes to the success of the organization. You know, so that's where the HR role comes in. So HR, that's what I said, you know, it has come a long way, just recruitment and a transaction to play a complete business partner role, understanding the issues that the CEO is facing and providing people solutions to those issues. And my personal view is 70-80% of the issues in the company are people issues. You know, how do we leverage these people, talent, human capital to address those issues? And most of the things will fall in place. That's my view.
Sanju, what is your rebuttal? Mr. Rao is saying very strongly that it's not the check which is the problem. It's the hand which signs the check, which we have to worry about.
No, I fully agree with NNR. There's no doubt about that. And I've seen that happening on the board of Agrotech Food, where NNR is fully involved. And we've seen what HR has been able to achieve over the last few years in terms of people, in terms of so many things, people doing much, much more, and how in spite of salary going up, or we've been able to do many more things with the same number of people as compared to anybody else. So definitely there's this thing. I was only differentiating between, I'm not saying it is not required in any company. I was just saying the difference is in terms of how important is it in HR, for example, in X company versus a company which is more into manufacturing and, you know, has less of marketing and stuff like that. So that was the point. But I want to get to Vivek's point about corporate strategy. See, Vivek, ultimately, you know, strategy is made in the boardroom, but actually it is the implementation which is the most important thing. Every industrialist in this country had a strategy, but only Dhirubhai Ambani could come and make India's largest company in, say, 30 years. Why? Because his implementation was flawless, absolutely flawless. And it continues to be that. You know, Jio could have been set up by anybody else all over the world. But today, you know, the price we pay for...
You've hit the nail on the head. It's all about execution. Strategy absolutely. By itself has no meaning. And I really like that definition of execution. The discipline of getting things done in time.
Yeah,
and I think you couldn't have said it better. It's at the end of it, without execution, we are just talking in the air.
But are you vacating your position, Vivek, that the most critical thing is business strategy?
Well, I think execution, you cannot say that's a function. That itself is an intermix of
operations. Operations.
No, but to execute something, you need to have a strategy first, no? Otherwise, exactly. You execute the wrong things.
It all has to start from there. Quite right.
But what about strategy? You make a strategy or you make a mission statement, it stays for 50 years. So it's the strategy is no longer important now. It's all the other things which are important. What do you feel, Rahul? You're a practicing operating person. Do you keep
your strategy? I'm telling you, one of my favorite quotes is from a person called Gurbakhsh Chahal, and he said it very well. He says, any strategy can be mimicked, any business model can be copied, any algorithm can be rewritten, but you can't do speed of execution. And that's what actually makes that. That's the anti-barrier that we also put in. So a lot many people have come and tried. You'll be surprised. I don't have a single competition for me, which itself is a problem. So our company is called BTB, which means better than before. So we keep saying, because we don't have a competition in the beer world.
Sorry no beer to chains. Interrupt. Can you tell which exactly is this beer business? Sorry.
So this is a chain of cafes, which we call the Beer Cafe. We're in 16 cities, sir. And we basically serve beer. And that's what we do. But every time somebody has tried to do something closer, they just realize it's the most regulated marketplace because of two reasons. One, liquor in India is, from a constitution point of view, you have to endeavor towards total prohibition of liquor. And that's why it's a state subject constitutionally. And 29 states are wet in a way that you could serve liquor. The other issue is that beer is the only liquor or alcohol beverage which expires. So you're sitting on a time bomb. You're sitting with a 6-month inventory. If it doesn't sell, you'll have to drain it out. And you've got this complex, regulated, one of the most difficult environments to work in. Every state in India is a country of Africa, not like a country of Europe when it comes to liquor laws. Between Delhi and NCR, just three states of Delhi, UP and Haryana, within 10 kilometers, you will see the rules change. We as a company file 600 returns a year just between GST as well as VAT, because we are still in VAT for liquor and GST for food. So it's the most complex business to be. But like I said, it's an execution game. Anybody who comes and tries and does it, it goes through a lot of upheaval. But you know, one thing that I want to bring to the table is something on the human capital side. And I, you know, human resources to me, human capital too. And what Mr. Rao said is absolutely right. We are a very, very human capital intensive company with 700 people within our organization. It's a fully front-led office. And we just have a very small team at the back end. He says, it's because of the front end we are there. And we will always tell everybody, we're not in the beer business serving people. We're in the people business serving beer. Wow. You just have to see it how it works. And it's exactly what it is. And I can give you one incident, again, very micro incident, because COVID is here and I have to obviously talk about it. I'm a funded company. I've gone through VC, private equity, and one day, inshallah, we'll go and list ourselves. We will go through that because we've been able to give everybody shares in our company. All of them have shares. I've not done an ESOP program. The ESOP program is there for few in terms because they understand it, but all others have a phantom share. So everybody will make money when we list ourselves for sure. That's done. But I can tell you what happened due to COVID. It's an interesting fact. When we went closed down in month of March, everybody went into lockdown on 25th of March nationally. We were closed down in the middle and the early Marches because every state started saying, you know, if you drink alcohol, something will happen. COVID will come out of it or something, whatever weird moral issues that, you know, everybody wears from a government and, you know, authority point of view. But having said that, we were closed very early and we had to furlough all of them because I didn't know how long this winter is going to be. You will be surprised. We closed, we had a furlough. I did not have money to pay salaries. And all of these people, these are literally minimum wages people, went back to their towns, wherever they come from. And they've all come back after 6 months. I'm not even asked for 1 rupee salary. For the 6 months, they've gone back. Not even 1 rupee salary. They've all come back and they've started working. I didn't have money to even pay uniforms. And they said, don't worry. We'll bring our old uniforms, we will dry clean them, we will get them washed, whatever. They're all working hard. And I said, you know what, we're still in trouble because we have a 50% occupancy rule. You know, business is not normal. People are not coming out. There's a fear of COVID. How do we do? He says, we'll take a salary cut. Imagine a guy who's getting a salary of 15,000 rupees, ready to take a salary cut. And I'll give you the flip side to it. The corporate office or so-called, you know, more educated people, the white collars, actually are the ones who are troubling me. So the blue collar is on my side and the white collar is giving me all this gyan saying, we want 6 months of this. We want settlement. We want severance and blah, blah, blah. I'm like, what? Like, this is what's happening. So the more educated guys are actually the one who are actually now trying to kind of, you know, literally arm twist me and saying, you not paid us on time and this didn't happen. And that, you know, we didn't have the money. We don't have reserves. You know, we will have to earn and then pay. And that's what's going to happen. So it's going to be a long journey for us. But I'm just trying to say the power of people. It's unbelievable how these people came back. And I can't tell you, it's cold out here right now in Delhi, Gurgaon, where we are. It's extremely cold. They're standing on their feet. They eat when they stand. We don't have chairs because we're a cafe format. You'll never see in a cafe format any staff sitting. They work 12 hours sometimes. Unbelievable. They go back home.
A lot of credit goes to you, I must say.
I'm just so blessed that this is what's happening. I'm just saying, this is the power of people. And at the same time, we have a gig economy, a Zomato and a Swiggy, where yesterday a human index came and they are the worst. Because, you know, they don't treat people from that perspective. It might be more provocative, but they've just given it's a gig economy, which means I'll pay you. Now you do whatever you want. They're not salaried people. They don't have health insurances. They have nothing. You know, we've taken a very expensive health insurance for all. Apart from ESI, which the government provides, we have a health insurance which allows our cleaner, the person who cleans the tables and our floors, to go to the same hospital as I go. Same hospital. Same room. That's the level of, we have a very, very robust health plan. I said, because this is one thing we can't get in India very well. Health is unfortunately run by private people. Mm-hmm. You know, schools are run by private people. And what the government's running is liquor business. Government should be running schools and colleges and hospitals, not bloody running the liquor business. They want to run liquor business across the country. Every state, the government wants to run. It's unbelievable, but that's the way it works.
Well, Rahul, you spoke very eloquently, but you picked up all the lies that Mr. Rao would want to have picked up. But anyway, that's what we want. We want all this coming out. I would like to pick up one point from what you spoke. You said, look, I've been in finance now for the last 4 or 5 months, breaking my head, and definitely for the next 6 months. But what do you see 1 year, 5 years, 10 years from now? Is finance as a critical issue going to pale into insignificance, and you have to get into other, be led by HR perhaps, or something else?
No, like Mr. Kulkarni put it the right way. It's basically all the five fingers make a fist and then you go and, you know, execute it. So there is no doubt that all of them come together. It's about right now, which finger you want to finger. So at the moment, I want to finger the finance finger.
I can add to what Rahul is saying, since I've also run a franchise business for Pizza Hut and some other formats. Basically, it is a people's business. And an excellent example is given how people, the front of the house people, have come to at the right time and risen. I mean, of course, it speaks very highly of his leadership. But if in the restaurant business, if we have to choose the dominant one, it is a people's business, and hence HR. Narasimha, I'm sure you will agree with me on that, relatively speaking.
100%. I agree with you, because it comes back to people. You know, you also said that strategy and execution we discussed. So execution is by people. So when Ram Charan also in his book, The Execution, he said that strategy is never a problem. Actually, it is execution which is the problem. So that's where the people make a difference. So definitely Rahul's example is the great example, because the leverage that he's getting today of his people strongly behind him is because of the HR policies that he has put in place. So it's the best example that he has shared, that the insurance policies that he has put in place, where he and his employees go to the same hospital. There is no hierarchy here. There is no differentiation here. So that's the right thing to do. And then that creates the environment that you needed for the long-term success of the organization.
Okay. I'm getting too many people who are supporting HR. So let me give you a challenge, or just the opposite. We all know Jack Welch. And what was his pet name? His pet name was Neutron Jack. And why was Neutron Jack? Because he sacked thousands of people. He closed down companies. He did the whole thing. And that was all based on what Vivek said, business strategy. He got out of a lot of the companies, and he made General Electric, again, very viable, vibrant, and profitable. So what do you say to that? Anyone can answer this.
Yeah, that's what Jack Welch said. His maxim was that if my particular business was not in the top two, then I have to disinvest. That was the basis on which he sold a lot of the businesses, if they were not in the top two.
And he made the success of General Electric.
GE. So I meant GE.
So do you think that supports your argument? For business strategy?
Because he said that they are dogs. Then you will have to put disproportionate amount of money to revive them. You'll never get the kind of margins you will get. The opportunity costs in other businesses are much higher. So why to sack why carry that baby for sentimental reasons? Yeah, right. The best is to disinvest and get out of it.
And that's
made a lot of sense to me, because once again we are back to strategy. This was a typical example of a corporate strategy at the macro level. But Narasimha is again coming back to, I think there's one big consensus emerging amongst all of us.
I see a consensus.
Whether it's strategy or whether it's finance, at the end, it's all how well you execute and actually realize those dreams. And without that, I think this is what the consensus is really coming out. Anyone wants to build on that would be interesting.
So I will just give a small data that if you take a look at the list of 50 top businesses in India today, or maybe 50 years ago, only those companies, very limited few, are there in the list today, which were there 50 years ago or 25 years ago. And those who have survived are companies which had abundance of cash flows to survive the kind of calamities like Rahul is facing today. And it's only the cash rich or the companies which have cash flows with them, they manage to survive. And these kind of calamities, they do happen something unforeseen. Maybe nobody had expected that COVID is going to drive us like this for 9 months. But then people who do not plan for these things, they do not manage to survive. So Sanjay, what would you say, and what would be your cash flow advice on this?
You see, to raise any cash, which is for capital expenditure or for growth, in a country like India, requires at least 6 months. So therefore, you really have to see what is your cash flow requirement over the next 6 months, over the next 1 year or 2 years, and then determine what is the kind of source from which you can get this kind of cash flow. Suddenly, for example, let's take this COVID. So many M&A opportunities have come up for various companies. But the point is, only those guys who did have certain amount of cash available with them are going to be able to take a benefit of this. Unless, of course, you're listed and you can offer your shares as payment for that company. So cash flow to that extent becomes extremely important. But I just wanted to add another thing, throw in another thing in the works, that going forward, there are two other specific areas which I see becoming extremely important for corporates. One is, this whole new thing about ESG, which is environment, social, and governance. And this is something which is going to be extremely important for all companies going in the future. And any investor or any lender is going to ask you, how are you doing on environment, on social related issues, and on governance? That's one. The second area, and unfortunately, this is one area which top management, frankly, according to me, does not understand anything, which is IT, cybersecurity, and what IT can do for you. Nobody understands what IT can do for you. It can do wonders in terms of what can happen to your company in terms of information, in terms of decision making, in terms of many, many other things, control. And what these two areas to me are going to determine a lot. In fact, you may even get money, even if your financials are not good, if you're very good in these two areas. So therefore, these two become things which we have not talked about, but I think
what you're saying, the success of banks like HDFC Bank and all, I would give very high because of the very good IT infrastructure that they developed. They would not have been where they are today if it had not been for
IT. You're right.
Please don't say that the CEOs don't have any clue about it.
No, I don't know whether you saw Aditya Puri's interview. He did not understand IT. He said, I went a few years back, I went to Silicon Valley And I spent 4 or 5 months over there and met all the young people and the techies to understand what is IT and how it can benefit HDFC Bank. And then he came back. But the thing is that he saw that it can benefit.
Exactly.
You know, that is something which you need to have a bit of a, what you call dur drishti.
Okay, I would like to put another perspective. So because our time is running out and we must pick this up. We did not, since we are, our panel was limited to four, we're not able to grab a champion for marketing. But really up till now, I'm a marketing person, but up till now, that's what we've been, you know, customer is king, the importance of USP, positioning, strategies, and we have been splitting hairs over that. And the success of companies like HUL and how they sell 30 brands of soaps because they position it right. And how it is new, improved, surf, you know, the words new, improved suddenly make all the difference. Or how you position Sensodyne. I would say perhaps marketing, you guys are all wrong. It's really marketing which you are overlooking. Okay, forget COVID and all these finance things for the next 3-4 months. But really, your future is spelled by marketing. Who would like to, can someone take this up?
Yeah, I can give a very, very ready example. And okay. That is, you know, where one of our products we had franchised for was Samsonite. And they introduced a product known as Cosmolite, which was the world's lightest and the world's toughest suitcase. They actually got the material which is used, you know, for these people, if you shoot, what do they call it? To prevent yourself being shot at.
Kevlar.
Yeah. Kevlar. Yeah. So basically they got that material and they produced the world's lightest and the toughest suitcase. But their problem was that it was, the message was not going across. And then they came up with this very vivid TV commercial, a series of commercials. And there they show this suitcase is there and here comes an SUV and all the wheels go up and it crushes it. And once the vehicle has passed, it comes bounces back to its original form.
And the sales. And
then they say, you can't crush a legend. So this is what marketing is. That ignited the imagination of the customer so much. Believe me, at least in the Gulf where I was, it became the bestseller model for them. And I say it's entirely because of the marketing function in this case.
So Rahul, isn't it finally marketing, whether we are raising money or we're being nice to our employees, ultimate goal is really our customer, because they're providing the revenue, they're providing the reason for us to be there. And yes, in short term, perhaps you have to doodle around with finance and all that. But in the long run, really, the crucial thing is all about marketing. Isn't that, Rahul?
It is. At the end of the day, I'm just saying marketing in itself as a word is more descriptive. But what do you stand for as a brand? What becomes your communication tool. So for me, it's more about what your brand communicates. It's not just about going and doing a roadshow just to get, you know, capital in my case, for example, finance, if I have to go that route, but it's all about what your customer sees you for. And that is what the entire, brand encompasses. And that's very important, because if jo dikhta hai, wo bikta hai. So there's no doubt about it. There is no doubt about it. You have to do that. But where it comes from is, what is your purpose for being, you know, what do you do? Today, for example, if Google doesn't need to market themselves or advertise themselves, they don't really need to, because it's kind of become, you know what Google does. So it is, sometimes you have to over-market yourself. You have to spend a lot of money. You have to go through it. I'll give you very closer in terms of a beverage chain called Starbucks. They really don't spend too much money on advertising and marketing. They have a very low budget for it, because wherever they go open, that becomes a placeholder. People go. I'll give you CCD for that matter. A different story now because of the reasons we all know. But, you know, it was a marker. CCD never had to advertise. It was a marker. Every time people go and says, you know what, you take a left from that CCD, you'll see a CCD, I'll see you there. So it became, you know, people start marketing that brand itself. So like I said, what's your purpose? Depending on that, you have to kind of, you know, put yourself, no doubt about it. You know, you have to be very, very communicative about what you do. Even hospitals are now advertising and marketing in their own way, even if they cannot technically, and they show some doctors and say, we have the best panel now. So I'm just saying, you have to sell. Yeah? There's no doubt about it. No doubt.
Okay. Since we have had a very fair and I think quite honest discussion, because people sometimes take positions and they feel they have to stick to it. So we have had, which is good in a way, but the question I'd like to ask each of the panelists, now that we have had an open discussion, and if I ask the question, which function, original question, but which function would really be critical to the success of the company in the next 5 to 8 years? We are not talking of the immediate 3-4 months, of course, money is there, but really in the next 5 to 8 months, I'll ask each one of you, would you like to change your position and say, in the perspective of the next 5 to 8 years, which function would be really the most critical, which will spell success for the company? We'll start with you, Rahul, since you're there.
If there was a function called execution, I would go with that.
Okay. Mr. Rao.
Yeah, so I agree with Rahul. I think execution is an important area for the next 5 to 8 years. All these projects to be executed, and they play a very important role. Yes.
So execution, is marketing another name for execution?
No, it's multifunctional, it's cross-functional.
You can put execution in every function, execution for human capital, execution for marketing, business strategy, everything. So,
slightly put, it's walking the talk, basically.
Yeah.
Okay. Sanju, do you also buy that it's execution, or really it's finance?
I personally think, if you ask me, strategy is the most important thing. And the reason for that is... And the reason for that is that there are so many changes which are taking place today in the world, that it is difficult to anticipate those changes and develop a strategy. So a strategy which, as you said, which lasts for 40, 50 years, which was what was there earlier, is no longer valid. And strategy probably changes every 6 months or 1 year or whatever it is. And therefore, with these changes taking place, new competitors evolve, new businesses evolve, the new ways of doing things evolve. And therefore, strategy becomes extremely important to me.
So Vivek, someone is taking your game, really. So
I'm also compromising and saying, yes, strategy by itself is just a dream. And until and unless you get your execution to ensure that the strategy which you have made, I think without it, it is incomplete and of no use. So,
okay, fine. We have had a very interesting and frank discussion, because we seem to have come to the same understanding. I mean, we started from 4 different positions, and we have not come to any one of those single positions. We have come to an entirely new idea, and we have said execution, if there is a department. And of course, it crosses many functions, actually. I would take that. It's not just marketing, but finance and HR and all that. So in a sense, this is a very good thing. So with that, I would like to go over to our questions from people. For one, I think we have also asked people to mark questions directly to the participant. So if you open your chat box, you may have some questions which I haven't seen. But I've got one question from Meghna Guha. Could you please request Rahul sir to answer this question? COVID has taught us to work from home and meeting in virtual mode. Is the marketing firm likely to use it post-COVID scenario also?
I didn't get that.
People are working from home. This works very well for companies like IT and software and whatnot and so forth. At the moment, even marketing companies are doing that. But once COVID thing is over, will companies go back to their normal mode of working? Or is there a permanent change in the way we work?
No, there will be some. I think there will be some people. I know that one of our audit firms called Deloitte, and it's one of the world's largest firms. And it's publicly stated that 30% of their workforce across the globe, they will do work from home because the consultants and certain financial functions can be operated. I know that a lot of social media, digital media people can work from home. It all depends on what your work function is. But from my perspective, we will have to work together. So I think whether it's working in an office or in an outlet or taking a meeting room, without that physical interaction, it's going to be tough. This whole, you know, fatigue of Zoom is just killing us right now. And we really want to see and touch and feel people, you know, when it becomes normal in terms of safety point of view. So right now, because there is a safety element, we're all staying at home. I definitely see everybody going back. You know, I'll give you from a restaurant perspective that it's been one industry which has been very resilient. It's seen everything. It's seen the World War, Spanish flu, World War One, World War Two. You know, lately the Katrina hurricane in 2005 in New Orleans, there were 900 restaurants there, 1200 of them. This shall pass and we will be back to the, you know, the vibrant industry that I come from, and but also from a perspective of, you know, having bustling offices and, you know, life will be normal very soon. We just have to go through this bend in the road. It's not the end of the road.
Okay, so that is, I think that's a good answer to Meghna. I have a comment, which is not a question. This is from Vilas Rajwade. And he says, in fact, he supports the panel, what they came to the finding. Strategy plus execution could well be the key for tomorrow's success. Okay, so very good cooking as far as the panel is concerned to come out with something new. So can the panelists check their chats and see if there are any questions been put to them?
You know, there is a similar question that came from Meghna, this Kajal Sharma. She is asking, the work from home culture due to COVID scenario at present, do you expect—
Can you add to it since you are an HR person? Yeah.
Yeah, continuation of this culture even post-COVID in the future.
Yeah.
My take on this is the organizations have definitely successfully experimented the work from home culture. It is unthinkable that actually work from home can happen for 9 months or 10 months like this. So they used to give 1 day in a week or 2 days in a week, or when at times the work from home culture used to be there. So this, in my view, this is going to be new normal. The work from home culture will be more liberally be granted by the organizations. I think it will continue. So those jobs which can be operated from work from home, I think they will continue to be there. There will be more liberal look at work from home culture. So organizations will definitely see more people working out of home. And that will also have an impact on the real estate, and then maybe office spaces will become more and more smaller, and people will meet together for meetings, but regular work probably can go out of home. So that's Kajal's, my view about work from home in future, Kajal.
Good, so you're qualifying Rahul's thing somewhat. Okay, more questions. Can anyone spot any more questions from their chat box?
No, I don't have any.
You don't have any.
So
I have, sir.
Yes, Rahul.
Yes. Somebody, a person called Abhishek Gupta, has said that your quote on stellar IPOs of Burger King India and Mrs. Bector Cremica is global markets chasing, being very liquid, and that's the money that's flowing in. And what he said is absolutely right. But like I said, if there's money out there in terms like this, and you have to grab it, and why not grab it? If the money's coming from, you know, Uncle Sam, I don't have a problem. The color and the smell of the money is the same. It's money after all. But, you know, on a serious note, I've been told that this year in 2020, US printed 23% of their entire currency ever. So that's the kind of money they printed. That money is there. There's definitely a lot of liquidity. Last 3-4 months, you know, look at the net FPI into India. It's one of the, it's the highest ever we've got. This month alone itself, you're already high on FPI. So I'm just saying, yes, money is coming in. Where's the money coming? It's coming in the capital market. And if people can gain from this and they can create wealth for their, you know, people who worked hard towards it, whether it's promoter or their institutional funds or their employees for that matter, why not? You know, it's we are all here to share you know, success with everybody that's involved in creating what they've been able to create. But yes, there is a huge amount of influx of capital. And I think this is the best time if somebody can actually play the market in the right way. No doubt about it.
Okay.
If I may add to what Rahul said, is absolutely right. But in both these IPOs, the amount of oversubscription for in the shares which were reserved for Indian individuals
are very, very high.
Clearly indicating that individuals also in India are subscribing to these shares quite a bit. Mainly for two reasons. One is, of course, the interest rates on FDs and other things have gone down so much that people want to move out of FDs into equities. And there's a lot of withdrawal from mutual funds because mutual funds have not been able to deliver the kind of returns which you know, people thought they would. And people feel that it is better to invest directly rather than through mutual funds and pay fees and still not get returns. So because of these two reasons, a lot of the oversubscription on the Indian portion is extremely high.
And whereas Burger King India was 100% book building, the retail portion was only 10% with limited cap of 2 lakh rupees on that.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
You're absolutely right. And I can tell you there's another thing I saw closer home. When I was 20, 25, I didn't even know what stock market or anything meant. I didn't even know anything called DMAT. My son is 20. He has a DMAT account. It's on a new age platform called Zerodha, for example. And this is what's happening. You know, yeah. The new age platforms are allowing them to trade on a, on an app. It's like WhatsApping to buy.
Yeah.
He just bought stock in some foreign company sitting on his app because there's a company in India which is now allowing you to buy stocks. So he just bought stock for Tesla. He bought stock, you know, he's just buying stock for Airbnb, which is at the craziest amount of an IPO, a stellar IPO. But I'm saying this is the new world where everybody's sitting on a click, like we are talking to each other due to this new technology and people are doing it. And I think, Mr. Kulkarni, that's what's happening. New avenues are coming in for being, you know, for capital to flow in.
Yeah.
It's no longer, you know, it's now it's like water. Everybody's in it.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay. Any more questions anyone has received?
We know there is one more question here. Vilas Rajwade. It's an interesting question. Should those in 60s coach those in 40s to develop those in 30s? Right? So it's very interesting. It's a good thought. Absolutely, actually. So those who are in 60s, I think they should mentor and coach those who are in 40s so that they can develop those who are in 30s. Absolutely. This coaching culture or a mentoring culture in the organizations is very important. So people with at 60, they have lots of experiences, you know. So if they are able to pass on that knowledge to for the people who are in 40s, they will be able to develop the people in 30s. Because those who are at 40 today, they don't have the experiences of that wealth of experience of those who are in 60s. So if you're as an organization, if you're able to manage that knowledge and then pass it on to the 40s, so that the youngsters who are coming into the organizations now, they will have the benefit of the whole 60 years of experience with them. So I think I support this, and this is good coaching culture that organizations should put in place.
Vinod, I have one question.
Yeah.
Which says, what will be the new job opportunities in the coming financial year?
Right. And what is your answer?
You see, as I said, if we are going to grow from $2.5 trillion to $5 trillion, what really happens is ultimately your expenses, yours, mine, or other people's expenses really don't grow in that proportion. So the amount of what a company would call free cash flow for an individual is what is the cash flow which he can do whatever he wants to do rather than just spend for his expenses. And that grows in dramatic fashion. So for example, if today it was earlier when we were lower, it was in the region of about 10%. It has now gone up to 17%. So on a three trillion, let's say a 17% of 3 trillion, it is expected to go up to 30% when you go to 5. So you do 30% on 5 versus 17% on 3. So the amount of money available to people for either investment or doing or property or whatever it is in the financial sector is going to be hell of a lot. So jobs in the financial sector will multiply significantly in these areas. Jobs in the financial sector in banking will reduce primarily because of IT. But investment, mutual funds, you know, raising money is something which is going to happen more and more. And that's where the jobs will be, not so much in banking.
Okay, there's one more question here, which is scope. What is the scope of direct selling post-COVID? Perhaps a lot of it has been hit right now. And perhaps Vivek may be a good person to start to answer this.
I need to repeat it. I couldn't get
what is the scope of direct selling? That means selling directly to the customer. Of course, a lot of direct selling is happening online, but in the past, it has been door to door. A lot of it has moved online. So what is the scope of direct selling post-COVID?
I think it is like a nasha. What has happened in the last several months, people have got addicted to it. And I don't think it's going to go back now. So to that extent, I think the physical retailing is definitely going to suffer. It'll, of course, remain. But the steep exponential increase it was seeing, I feel it has now been dented, and direct selling is certainly, it's something like in, you know, in the restaurant business, that dining in has come down and delivery and takeaway have become exponentially high. It's something similar is happening in the retailing industry now. And it's been very, very dramatic. People initially was coerced, sort of coerced into it, but now they've just realized it's so convenient. And, you know, with people like you buy an, I bought a tracksuit the other day from Amazon and my size was wrong. And the next day they took it back. So even that aspect that, you know, you may land up ordering wrongly, even that has been taken care of. And in terms of increase in the price, I don't think that I'm paying any extra price for it. So if you look from all possible parameters, I feel this is the line of the future. Sanju, maybe some more jobs in that?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I've seen you know, companies today who are only doing selling on the net. There are many, many companies, especially in cosmetics and, you know, products which can be shipped directly. Men's cosmetics, especially women's cosmetics, other things like that. Which are only on the net. They don't have any physical presence whatsoever.
Okay.
There are people today, in fact, we met one guy who only gives loans to you on the net. They don't have a single office other than an office in Bangalore. And they give you a loan of, and he's saying that they are disbursing. I was surprised to hear this. They are disbursing at the rate of 1200 crores per year, only on the net, nothing else. Sanction is given on the net, money is given to you in half an hour, directly into your bank account.
Fantastic. So really, clearly, this is the direction that things are happening. We'll take one last question. I think it has been a very vibrant discussion, and that's how we are. This last question, I think Mr. Rao may be able to handle this. Okay, what type of jobs will become irrelevant due to technology development?
Actually, when technology is in its peak, every job can be irrelevant, you know, so we need to be prepared for that. There are factories in US completely run by robots. So it's going to happen. But some of the core things like we've talked about strategy, we talked about execution, we talked about human capital, these jobs are going to remain. And in a different shape and form. So like, for example, in India itself, when the computers were to be launched in way back in 80s, there was a huge uproar that this is going to take away a lot of jobs. Even people like Atal Bihari Vajpayee has objected in the parliament that it is going to be a drastic decision. Don't put in computers in India, which is a labor intensive country. We are going to lose a lot of jobs. But it has not happened. Actually, the computers actually have developed more jobs. So more technology will create more jobs. Like Sanjay said, technology is going to help organizations, help people to find more jobs. So some jobs will be irrelevant, but more jobs will come into play. Like we said, the direct selling is going to be redundant, but e-commerce will develop. So those jobs will get shifted to e-commerce. So nothing is going to happen to jobs per se over a long period of time.
Thank you, Mr. Rao. We have more questions, but time is short. So we will end with that. I must say, we have really had a very dynamic, frank discussion. And I think a lot of us are taking learnings from it, all of us, whether, as someone said, whether we are in our 60s or 40s or 30s. So with that, I would request Sunil to come online and propose a vote of thanks.
Thanks.
Yes.
Thanks. It was a very lively discussion today and wish we had more and more time to carry it on. But my special thanks to all the panelists, Rahul Singh, Mr. Narasimha Rao, Sanjay Kulkarni, and Vivek Pandey. But yes, I think in the end, everyone realized that strategy and its implementation is more important. But if I have one chance to say one sentence, it's more important that who we put in that place to devise the strategy and to implement it. And that's where Mr. Narasimha Rao comes. Okay. So thanks, everyone.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity, Vinod and Anil.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, all the panelists.
Thanks, Anil. Thanks, Vinod.
Talking off.